Good to see everyone here this morning. Let me get everyone to stand, and we're going to praise the Lord this morning. We're going to worship Him. The song we're going to sing is, I Will Celebrate. Let's put your hands together. There you go.
Celebrate, sing unto the Lord, sing to the Lord a new song. I will celebrate, sing unto the Lord, sing to the Lord a new song. I will celebrate, sing unto the Lord, sing to the Lord a new song.
Everybody doing today? Amen. You know, I've seen a lot of people out there just like me. I'm not sure if it's a real word, but you are rhythmically challenged. When they said the clap, we're all looking around. Okay, when do I got? Hey, just look at your neighbor, okay, and just clap with them, okay, and it'll be all right. Amen. Amen. Hey, would you bow and pray with me this morning? Father God, thank you so very much that we can be here to sing a new song, because this is a brand new day that we have never experienced before, and it is all because God, our Creator, you woke us up today. God, you opened our eyes, and so God, help us to open our hearts and to open our mouths and to worship you today now, Father God. So I thank you just for blessing this worship experience. Saturate this place with your presence, dear God, and we'll just praise you for whatever the results may be, dear God. Lord, you've already done the scan and the inventory on every person, every man, woman, and student that's here today, and you know the need. We know and believe that you can meet the need that is here in every heart. So may you be glorified is our prayer, and we know you want to answer this prayer, so we believe it in faith, and we believe it in Jesus' name we pray. And all of God's people said, amen. 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 You may please take your seat. We have welcomed God here. We want to take this time to welcome you here. Whether you're a long-time member or a first-time guest, thank you so very much for choosing to set your alarm and get up and come and worship Jesus with us today. However, if you are a first-time guest, we definitely are delighted to have you with us today. And we'd like to give you a connect card. It's just our way of reaching out to you. So if you are a first-time guest, would you please raise your hand today? Right or left, it don't matter. We'll catch the hand. We got one down here on the front down here. We get one of our deacons to give them a connect card. Anybody else? We don't overlook anybody. Buried back, we got. Thank y'all so very much for choosing to be here. Please take this connect card and fill out both sides of it. And at the end of our service, take it with you back to the welcome table at the back. And one of our greeters from our greeters team will give you a gift from our church we'd like you to take with you. The other announcements to go as follows: that on July 1st, Brother Bill DeLeon will be his first day on the job as our full-time student pastor. We've already voted him in. His first day will be July 1st. Coming up on July 2nd is the IDN Interfaith Dinner Ministry. You can see Brother John Itak back there. Brother, wave at me, please. That's John Itak. If you're interested on getting involved with that ministry, you can see Brother John Itak for more information on that. Next Sunday night, after our evening services, we'll have a finance committee meeting. And by the way, next Sunday morning during our AM worship service is when we will observe Independence Day. You know, so we didn't do it this day. This Sunday we chose to do it the day following the 4th. So next Sunday we'll incorporate in our service a celebration for an observance of Independence Day. The office will be closed on Monday following that. July 13th and 18th are the dates for Power Life Youth Camp. So I appreciate y'all keeping them in your prayers. And towards the end of this month, just another date for you to keep in mind is July 24th. It's a Friday night. We will show the movie Do You Believe? That we'll show it at 7. And we'll have more information to follow on that. And we're still in the process of working on getting the flyers for you to hand out and et cetera and so on. So help me welcome Miss Janice. Don't she look lovely today? Amen. Miss Janice Hendricks right there.
My pastor, the Reverend John Kasper. No, I'm not going there today. But anyway, we had a good Sunday school today. We had 138. I'm expecting 150 in a few short weeks, and if we reach that goal, I've got a few things in my mind. I haven't talked to the pastor yet, but I will. We had some visitors today. We appreciate you being here. Also, in Sunday school, we have some of our adult classes. They do a lot. They take money up, and they're always helping different ministries, and if they find out a need. And I really appreciate that. Our classes have a lot going on, so if you're not a part, I'd love for you to join in with that. They also go out to eat quite a bit, too, but they do a lot in those classrooms. Brother John, you look nice today.
Amen. Thank you.
You really do, don't you? That's all I got. I'm not going there.
You know, along the lines of our Sunday school ministry, you know, as a pastor, it's a blessing, you know, that when I'm headed to somewhere to minister to a family, and, you know, whatever the need may have been, it's awesome to know that their Sunday school teacher or one of the outreach persons from that class has already been there, or I meet them at the hospital. And so I'm just saying this, it's great to know, you know, that I'm not the only one doing ministry. You know, that our leadership team has wrapped your minds, and you're also embracing these ministering to your class. So I thank you so very much for that, knowing that it's not a Lone Ranger Christian type approach where I'm doing this all by myself, but you are on the field with me. So I appreciate that. I just want to let you know that on a Sunday morning, I want to take time to let you know how much I appreciate that. And with that being said, would you please stand your feet and let's have a moment of fellowship today, please. Thank you.
return to your seats, let's sing Saved, Saved, Saved.
I found a friend who is all to me. His love is ever true. I love to tell how he lifted me and what his grace can do for you. Saved by his power divine, saved to new life sublime. Life now is sweet and my joy is complete, for I'm saved, saved, saved. He saves me from every sin and harm, secures my soul each day. I'm leaning strong on his mighty arm. I know he'll guide me all the way. Saved by his power divine, saved to new life sublime. Life now is sweet and my joy is complete, for I'm saved, saved, saved. When poor life now is sweet and my joy is complete, for I'm saved, saved.
sing Redeemed, How I Love to Proclaim It. And this will be our offertory hymn.
Father, I want to thank you this morning for letting us be here. Father, I want to thank you for such a beautiful day. Father, I want to thank you for each one that's here. Father, if there's one here this morning that don't know thee, Father, we pray they won't leave this building before it's too late. Father, we just pray for the sick in our community, heal other bodies back with us. Father, just be with our pastor this morning. Give him the words to make each one of us realize that we all be walking a closer walk with thee. Father, now as we take up this offering, may it be used to glorify thee, for we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
You know, we all go through trials. We all do. If you're feeling hopeless and alone today, I just want to let you know that it's a prayer away. Help is there. And you know, my Lord and Savior will wrap his arms around you, and he'll just love you until you're strong enough to get through. You just have to depend on it.
Thank you.
in the darkness I lay weeping, feeling hopeless and alone. No place to run, no one to turn to. On the edge of hanging on, what faith I had was shaken, and I cried out in desperation. Hope and unafraid. From your act of tender mercy, once again I found my way. Just when I thought my world was ending, you showed me a new beginning. Like a soft rain falling, you came to me and made me in your love. Into your arms, like a baby I came crawling. You held me there till I was strong enough. And I prayed a prayer and I was heard. From heaven to earth. Whoa. From heaven to earth, like a soft rain falling, you came to me and bathed me in your love. Into your arms, like a baby I came crawling. You held me there till I was strong enough. And I prayed a prayer and I was heard from I was heard from heaven to earth. Amen.
Morning. How's everybody doing this morning? Brother Keith, I appreciate that song. It's always hard following up one of his songs. He does such a great job with all of his songs, and we appreciate it. This morning, I'm going to return the favor to somebody that embarrassed me up here. Today is Terry's birthday. So do we have any other birthdays out there this week, today? No other birthdays out there? So if you don't mind, help us just sing happy birthday to her real quick. Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
Thank you.
The song we're going to be singing this morning is Overcome, and he has overcome. That's all I can really think to say about that. So if you can, stand and help us sing the song.
Seated above, enthroned in the Father's love, destined to die, poured out for all mankind. God's only Son, perfect and spotless one. He never sinned, but suffered as if he did. All authority, every victory is yours. All authority, every victory is yours.
Say your now.
Awesome and powerful forever. Awesome and great is your name. You speaking the Father's plan, sending us out, light in this broken land.
Let's be the light for him.
All authority, every victory is yours. Jesus, awesome and powerful forever. Awesome and great is your name. You overcame. We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Everyone overcome. We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Everyone overcome. We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Everyone overcome. We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Everyone overcome. Savior, Jesus, awesome and power forever, awesome and great is your name.
You can be seated.
Amen. I'm glad he's not the only one who's overcome. He helps us overcome. Can I get a witness? Amen. Thank you, choir. Thank you, praise team. Brother Keith, appreciate that. You know, I do not know where you keep finding these songs that I've never heard before, but do me a favor and keep finding them, please. That really ministers to me. I appreciate that. Amen. Please take a copy of God's Word and find in your Old Testament the book of 2 Samuel chapter number 9. As you see on the screen there, our subject today is Dining with Deity. Dining with Deity, 2 Samuel chapter number 9. And when you find your place in God's Word, if you can physically stand with me in honor and reverence the reading of the Word of God today out of 2 Samuel chapter number 9, beginning at verse 1. And David said, "Is there yet any that I have left of the house of Saul, that I may show him kindness for Jonathan's sake?" And there was one of the house of Saul, the servant, whose name was Ziba. And when they had called him to him, David, the king said to him, "Art thou Ziba?" And he said, "Thy servant is he." And the king said, "Is there not yet any of the house of Saul, that I may show him the kindness of God unto him?" And Ziba said unto the king, "Jonathan hath yet a son, which is lame on his feet." And the king said to him, "Where is he?" And Ziba said unto the king, "Behold, he is in the house of Machir, the son of Amiel, in Lodabar." Then King David sent and fetched him out of the house of Machir. We know they're from the south because he got fetched, amen? And fetched him out of the house of Machir, the son of Amiel from Lodabar. Now when Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, was come unto David, he fell on his face and did reverence. And David said, "Mephibosheth?" And he answered, "Behold thy servant." And David said to him, "Fear not, for I will surely show thee kindness for Jonathan thy father's sake, and will restore thee all the land of Saul thy father, and thou shalt eat bread at my table continually." And he bowed himself and said, "What is thy servant thou shouldest look upon such a dead dog as I am?" Then the king called to Ziba, Saul's servant, said to him, "I have given unto thy master's son all that pertained to Saul and to all his house. Now therefore thy sons and thy servants shall till the land for him, and thou shalt bring in the fruits that thy master's son may have food to eat. But Mephibosheth, thy master's son, shall eat bread alway at my table." Now Ziba had 15 sons and 20 servants. Then said Ziba unto the king, "According to all that my lord the king hath commanded his servant, so shall thy servant do. As for Mephibosheth," said the king, "he shall eat at my table as one of the king's sons." And Mephibosheth had a young son whose name was Micah. And all that dwelt at the house of Ziba were servants unto Mephibosheth. So Mephibosheth dwelt in Jerusalem, for he did eat continually at the king's table, and was lame on both his feet. Would you pray with me? Thank you so very much, Father, for what has already transpired in your service today. And we thank you for capturing our attention. Draw us into to your table so that we can dine with Deity. Thank you for what you'll accomplish through the preaching of your word. We pray this believing that you would speak deep in our heart for Jesus' sake. And all of God's people said, amen. You may be seated. Dining with Deity. I hope you get the picture. I hope you can try to get the imagery of this awesome dinner that Mephibosheth was invited to. And by the way, just to let you know, this is perhaps one of my personal all-time favorite stories of the Old Testament. Just for, you know, there are some major, major storylines in the Old Testament, but to me, this story here, I've always just been just encompassed. It's with the grace and just the mercy that we see here. You know, there are other major themes and storylines, but this obscure passage kind of tucked away in the midst of tons of gems of grace that we see all throughout the Old Testament. Perhaps this story here, the treatment, the kindness, or the compassion that King David showed to Mephibosheth. And just for the sake of time, when I get to Mephibosheth, I may not pronounce his whole name, but if you hear me say Miff, you know who it is, okay? So Miff is going to be short for Mephibosheth today, in the instance that I just want to abbreviate his name. But, you know, this is an actual, we know, we just read the story. This was an actual historical account, but it also doubles to us as a parable, and it shows us the grace of God and how it is a wonderful surprise, and it is too good not to be true. So look with me in this passage today. I want to show you in verse 1 that God reaches out to us because of who God is. I'm saying it one more time. God reaches out to us, not necessarily because of who we are, but God reaches out to us on the basis of who that He is. Verse 1, and David said, if you can imagine, here's King David. He's on his throne. I can just imagine him. And he makes this decree. He said, is there yet any that is left of the house of Saul that I may show him kindness for Jonathan's sake? Now, just to bring everybody in the building up to speed, if you're not sure with Old Testament history, King Saul was the very first king of Israel, and he had a son named Jonathan. And Jonathan and David, man, they were BFFs. They were best friends forever. They just made a pact, and they made a covenant, and they made an agreement that come no matter what, that they would always, always show favor to each other. And King David made a vow and a promise to Jonathan that he would always show favor to his household. So we see here in this passage that David said, and now this is long after Saul had died, and Jonathan was killed in battle, that David, we can imagine him kind of recollecting back and to the vow and to the promise he made to Jonathan. And so he made the decree, is there any left of the house of Saul that I might show him the kindness? See, I want you to see this as a glimpse, and it's a picture of the grace of God. Because King David did not have to do that. Do you know that? He did not have to do that. And see, he was not forced to do that. You know, he was not talked into it. He didn't owe it to anybody. And man, if that's not a picture of the grace of God, I don't know what is. Because see, we don't deserve what God has done for our lives. Can the church say please say amen right there? Because we don't deserve it. And God never was forced to save any of us. No greater power than God forced him to show up in the day he showed up in our lives and save us. And by the way, just to let you know this, God does not owe us anything. But listen, because of what Jesus has done, we can experience everything that God has to offer to us. And I don't know where you're at. I'm not sure how you kind of unpack that in your mind. But that takes this little mind of mine and just blows it away, because I know, and I hope I'll never forget that I have not done anything to deserve what Jesus has done for me. And I know when God reached down for me, he was not reaching down because I was a good little old boy there in Ocean Way doing what I was supposed to do. But how many know that God, the Bible says in Romans 5:8, that he demonstrated, he showed us his love even when we were yet sinners. Jesus died for us, not on my best day, but on my worst day. So we see a picture of the grace. David was not forced, but he wanted to show compassion. And we see on the external side of it in verse 2, there was a house of Saul, a servant's name was Ziba. And when they called him David, the king said unto him, art thou Ziba? And he said, thy servant is he. And the king said, is there not yet any of the house of Saul that I may show him the kindness of God unto him? And Ziba said unto King Jonathan, hath yet a son which is lame on his feet. So number one, God reaches out to us because of who he is. And number two, God reaches out to us for the sake of another. I believe I'll say that one more time. God reaches out to us for the sake of another. God was reaching out to Mephibosheth on the behalf of somebody else. Verse 1, you see there? And David said, is there not yet any that is left of the house of Saul that I may show him kindness for whose sake? Jonathan say? Who was Jonathan? Jonathan was the son of the king. He was the son of Saul. And if you're sitting here today and you have experienced the compassion of an all-benevolent, all-loving God, I want you to know he didn't do it for your sake. Jesus, or God, saved you on the behalf of his son's sake, the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why we can be here today and have what we have as from being a Christian is because of what Jesus has done for us. So God reaches out to us for the sake of another, for his son, the Lord Jesus Christ. So we see the external reason why David sought out someone was to show them the kindness on behalf of Jonathan. But look at verse 3, it gets even better than that. God reaches out to us in spite of us. That'll bless you. God reaches out to us in spite of us. Verse 3 says there, and the king said, is there not yet any of the house of Saul that I may show him the kindness of God unto him? Now remember, who's King David speaking to? Ziba. He was a servant of Saul. Saul should have known everybody that was on the roster, everybody that would have been qualified as part of the family of the household of Saul. And here's what Ziba says in verse 3. He says, and Ziba said to the king, I'm reading verse 3, the latter part of verse 3, and Ziba said to the king, Jonathan hath yet a son which is lame on his feet. Did you notice he didn't even mention his name? He didn't say, now that you bring it up, King David, there is Mephibosheth. He's over there in Lodabar. Listen, he didn't even bring up his name. You know, I believe Ziba thought that Mephibosheth was such an embarrassment that he had nothing to offer because he was crippled and he was lame. He couldn't do anything for the king. He couldn't help him. He couldn't hurt him. So he didn't even mention his name. He just said, oh, yeah, by the way, King David, now that you bring it up, Jonathan, he had a son, but he's lame on his feet. He's just a nobody. He has nothing to offer. But I want you to know verse 4, and the king said to him, Where is he? Aren't you glad that even though we had nothing to offer to God, although we might not have been a superstar spiritually, that when nobody looked at us, you know, sociology has a principle and it's sad, but it's so true, that teaches us that often we embrace other people's perspectives of our lives. You know what that means? It means when we know that somebody's formed an opinion about us, we begin to live out other people's opinions of us. And that's never healthy, right? That's never good, because people always look at us and they always give us the worst kind of treatment. They always give us the worst kind of label. But aren't you glad when God looks at us, he didn't look at us for what the reputation of people say about us. God looks at us through the eyes and through the prism of grace. King David said, where is he? Yeah, I don't care if he's crippled. I don't care what he has to offer. It matters not to me that he's lame. Just, where is he? Where is he? In verse 4, the king said, and where is he? And Ziba said to the king, behold, he's in the house of Machir, the son of Ammiel, in Lodabar. Then King David sent and fetched him out of the house of Machir, the son of Ammiel, from Lodabar. And you know why they couldn't find him, right? They couldn't find him at first because he was below Debar. You'll get on your way home. Read it again. It's in there. Verse 6. Y'all come on back now. Come on back. Now when Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, was coming to David, he fell on his face and did reverence. And David said, Mephibosheth. Now you just got to understand this. I got to take a few minutes to explain this to you. You got to understand. Mephibosheth, when he was 5 years old, how old was he? When he was 5. He's a grown man here, but when he was 5. Saul, his grandfather got killed in battle. His father Jonathan got killed in battle. And when his person that was watching him, his nurse, when they heard word that his father and grandfather was killed in battle, he picked him up when he was 5 to rush him out of the house and dropped him. He dropped Mephibosheth, and that's how his feet became lame and crippled. So for the rest of his life, here is this descendant of Saul, this son of Jonathan. He was born into royalty, but he is living in isolation. He's living in obscurity. Listen, when any new king came to the throne, they would normally annihilate and kill the predecessor's family so they would not have any attacks to the throne. So King David could have wiped him out. King David could have killed him. So can you imagine? Here's Mephibosheth. He's a grown man. He's crippled. He never goes anywhere. He's bound up. He's bound up in his house for the rest of his life. Then that knock comes to the door all of a sudden. One of his servants looks out the window. It's David. It's David. It's David's servants. What do you think the first thought came to his mind was? I'm gone. He found me. He discovered me. He's gonna wipe me out. I'm part of the former regime. He's going to kill me. So when we see in verse 6 that when Mephibosheth came before David, that he fell on his face and he did reverence. And he just knew, I believe he just knew his days were numbered. But David said, Mephibosheth, just called his name, and he answered, Behold, thy servant. And David said to him, Fear not, for I will surely show thee kindness for Jonathan thy father's sake, and will restore thee all the land of Saul thy father. And thou shalt eat bread at my table continually. Can you imagine Mephibosheth down on his face? He's thinking the executioner's about just to whack his head off. But instead of that, all of a sudden, out of nowhere, he wasn't expecting this. David said, Mephibosheth, I got great news today. Today thou shalt not die, you will live. Not only am I going to let you live, all of your father's inheritance, I'm going to give it all back to you. Everything you lost, you're getting it all back. Mephibosheth's been like, come again? Speaking to my good ear, did I hear that right? You know, I once heard a story about this guy who stole a Volkswagen Bug, and the entire police force was searching for him. The entire police, must have been a small town, but the entire police force was searching for him because the owner of the Volkswagen Bug reported to the police that he left a pack of crackers on the seat that he had put rat poison in to kill some rodents at his house. So the entire police force is trying to catch him, not to lock him up, but to save his life. Hey, y'all getting this today? Listen. Jesus is not trying to attack you with this big old spiritual Bible and whop you over the head with it and force you to become a Christian. Listen, he is not pursuing you like he is and sending Christian neighbors your way and Christian coworkers your way and Christian students on your baseball team and et cetera, et cetera. He's not doing this to bind you up spiritually. He's coming after you because he loves you. You all right with that? He's not coming after you to bind you up spiritually, but to save your soul and to liberate your life. When Mephibosheth got before David, you never hear King David say, oh, by the way, how'd you get them crippled feet? Tell me, what happened? You know what? David didn't care how it happened. Is that right? If he cared, he would have asked. He's a king. He can ask what he wants to ask. So, man, how'd you get yourself in this situation? What led you to this? You know, what got you to be such a cripple, so independent, so dependent upon other people to take care of you? How did you get here? Are we guilty at times of kind of stereotyping somebody? And instead of loving them, we trying to evaluate them. Well, how'd you get into that sin? How'd you become that? Listen. And I believe this, I got deep convictions about this, that God cares more about our present and our future than he does our past. God cares, listen, God is not concerned with where we have been, but listen, he shows up in our lives and he wants us to experience his grace so that he can change the destiny of our lives so that we'll not continue on the same road we're going, but he will free us up and put us on the highway to heaven and so that we can experience the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you remember the day that grace invaded your life? Do you remember that day? Do you remember the day that grace invaded your life? Here's Mephibosheth down on his face, and he knows that death is imminent, but instead of death, he experiences the grace, and he experiences life. Grace invaded his life that day. Do you, sir, ma'am, do you remember the day that grace invaded your life? Here's Mephibosheth. Here's Mr. Miff. He's over there in Lodabar. Lodabar, it means barren. It means no pasture. It means there's nothing going on there in Lodabar. He's over there. He has nothing. He is nothing. He's poor. He's an outcast. He's crippled. He has nothing. But the day that grace invaded his life, and I'm about to get a spell up here, the Bible says that King David said to Mephibosheth, from this day forward, you will be at my table continually. It was not just a one-time showing of grace where David kind of just threw a bone at Mephibosheth. Well, I love Jonathan so much, I'm gonna let old Miff come and eat at my table for one day. Not because I love Mephibosheth, but because I love Jonathan. It was nothing just of a glimpse of grace. He got the whole thing of grace. When Jesus gets a hold of us, he does not want us to experience grace just for one day. Jesus wants to bring us to the table of grace, and he wants us to dine with him for all of eternity. Grace invaded his life. Listen, he was a nobody and seated among all of the somebodies. Can you imagine him there? King David sitting at the end. Absalom, young, good-looking, perfect Absalom with the beautiful-looking hair over here. Then you got all the princes, all the princesses. You got all the beautiful wives of David. You got all the statesmen. Man, you got them all right there. And here is a nobody, Mephibosheth. Instantly, because of grace invaded his life, he's seated amongst all of the somebodies. Am I speaking to anybody today? That you might be in a low debar in your life. You might be out there in what you think is obscurity somewhere. You don't have nothing. You're going nowhere fast. There's nothing to stake anything to, no claim of anything. But listen, if you let Jesus invade your life with grace, you will be a nobody seated in the midst of somebody. And I'm not talking about me seated at the table with me, because there's coming a day. The Bible teaches about a marriage supper of the Lamb. When all of the children, all of the bride of Christ will sit down. Hey, every good wedding has a reception. Is that right? Hey, is that right? Every good wedding has a reception. Right now, I am married to the Lord Jesus Christ, and I'm waiting for the consummation day that'll take place in the reception of heaven at the marriage supper of the Lamb, and we will sit down and we will dine with Deity. Grace. What did grace do? Grace did everything. Mephibosheth, this is just so good. You see why this is my favorite? He came to the king with nothing, and he left with everything. He left with everything. I've been saved 20 years. When I come to Jesus, It didn't take much for me to give him all that I had. I didn't have anything. I didn't have much. I'm 16. I'm ignorant on a lot of things. So it wasn't, looking back, it wasn't that big of a decision just to give him everything. I didn't have much. But right now, listen, even the little bit I have, he still deserves it all. Because I came to him with nothing. And because of that, because of grace invading my life, I will leave this place with everything. Or lose place with everything. Romans 8, beginning at verse 14, the Bible says this: for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. For you do not receive the spirit of bondage, again to fear, but you receive the spirit of adoption, by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. Grace removed fear from his life. Verse 7, David said to him, fear not, for I will surely show thee kindness for Jonathan, thy father's sake. So grace removed fear, but grace provided a future. Look at verse 7, the latter part of verse 7. David says, and I will restore thee all the land of Saul, thy father, and thou shalt eat bread at my table. How often? Continually. Verse 10, thou therefore thy sons and thy servants shall till the land for him, and thou shalt bring in the fruits that thy master's sons may have food to eat. But Mephibosheth, thy master's son, shall eat at my bread always, continually. Verse 13, so Mephibosheth dwelt in Jerusalem, for he did eat continually at the king's table and was lame on both of his feet. Grace changed. Grace removed his fear. Grace provided a future. But did you notice? We can't help but notice this. It's difficult to overlook this, that Mephibosheth had a son named Micah. Now David's instructions were, Mephibosheth, he'll eat my table continually. But I want you to see that when grace invades, this has been a good word last week for Father's Day, when grace invades the father, grace has a good chance of invading the family. Back in Lodabar, Mephibosheth couldn't provide for his son Micah. But did you notice when grace invaded his life, when he got before King David said unto Ziba, Saul's servants, Ziba, you've got 15 sons and 10 servants. Is that right there? What am I reading at? Okay, verse 11. There was a lot of them, okay? A lot of them. David's instructions were to Ziba, your servants and your children are to work the fields to provide for Mephibosheth's children and his family. I want you to see that as a father, as a mother, as an adult, when grace invades your life, grace has the opportunity to invade the life of your family. So grace removed the fear. Grace, it provided the future. But grace provided a family. Look at verse 11. Then said Ziba to the king, according to all that my lord the king hath commanded his servant, so shall thy servant do. As for Mephibosheth, said the king, he shall eat at my table as one of the king's sons. He was adopted right into the family of God. You see, it wasn't just like I said earlier, just a one-time showing of compassion. David brought him in continually. Verse 13. This is repeated four times, but I'm going to read it once in verse 13. So Mephibosheth dwelt in Jerusalem, for he did eat continually. Where at? At the king's table. I can imagine, I got my spiritual thinking cap on, in my sanctified imagination, I can see David. He's already seated at the table. Absalom's there. You know, Abigail, maybe some other wives of King David are there. The princes, Joab, his general, mighty warrior of David, he's seated at the table. And on Mephibosheth, I don't know how it looked, but maybe he was carried. Maybe he came dragging a leg behind him. But I don't know how he got there. But once he got there, once he got to the king's table, once he got pulled up to the table, the king's table covered those crippled legs, and he looked like everyone else because he had been covered by the king's table. Listen, when we come to Jesus, when we come to our heavenly king, his grace covers us, and we look like every other child of God. It don't matter what the handicap was. The king's table covered it. It does not matter today what your background looks like. It does not matter what your past looks like, because God is more concerned about where you are and where you're going than where you have been. That's a good reason why the windshield is bigger than the rearview mirror, because where you've been does not matter. Where you're going means so much more than where we have been. So listen, when you come to King Jesus and grace invades your life, his grace will cover your life. Verse 5. Then King David sent and fetched him out of the house of Machir. My question for you, is God fetching you today? The king went looking for the one he wanted to display and show his grace to. When I got saved, the king was looking for somebody to show his grace to. When you got saved, the king was looking for you to show his grace to. Sir, ma'am, are you here today and you're not saved? If you're not saved, listen, I promise you with all the authority that's in the Bible, I promise you with all that is in me as a minister of the gospel, it is the will of God for you to be saved and secured and seated at the king's table. But sir, ma'am, you must choose to say yes to the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember old Mephibosheth? Remember he's on his face in fear and trembling, not knowing which way the outcome was going to go, thinking that it was going to go the other way and that his days were numbered. Can you imagine this scene unfolding? King David, when he said what he said according to biblical narrative, where he said, I'm going to restore to you all the land that was your father's, and from this day forward, you will not miss a meal because you will always be seated. You'll always have a place at the king's table. Can you imagine if old Mephibosheth looked up and said, no, I'm good. Appreciate it. I'm going back to Lodabar. David, do you know what I have in Lodabar? Is nothing, but I'm going back to Lodabar, and I'm just going to go back to my misery. I'm going to go back to my crippled bed. I'm going to go back to nothing. I'm going to go back to the obscurity. Thanks, but no thanks. You know what we'd have labeled him? A fool. Is that right? would have labeled him a fool to reject the grace of a king. Sir, ma'am, I want to encourage you. I'm not here today to call you a fool, but it would be very foolish to have King Jesus lay out the red carpet for you, give you this invitation to allow grace to invade your life, only for you to say, no, I'm good. I don't need you. I don't need organized religion. I don't need the cross. I don't need the resurrection. I'm gonna just go on back to my own life, my own way of living. Here's a good verse for where we are as a society. There is a way that seems right unto man, but the ends thereof are the ways of destruction. You can keep on living the way you are and living apart from Jesus Christ and hoping that you make heaven one day. Maybe you found some other way which you think is going to bring you peace and satisfaction and eternal bliss. I hope it works out for you. But upon the final authoritative word of God, it's not going to work out for you. And there's only one way for it to work out for you, and that's for you to come to the terms of the situation that the Bible says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. You can try to work and try to reach up to heaven all you want to, but will always fall short. The Bible says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Bad news. The good news is that Jesus reached down to us when he came 2,000 years ago to do for us what we could not do, and that is to die as a perfect sacrifice. Jesus did that all in anticipation that you'd be seated here today in the month of June the 28th, 2015, so that grace could invade your life. Would you like to be seated at the King's table for all of eternity? I promise you this. I've never been to hell, but I promise you, I've never been to heaven either, but I promise you, going to heaven is so much better than the alternative. Sir, ma'am, would you say yes to Jesus? Romans 10:13 says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. What did King David say in verse 1? And David said, is there yet any that is left of the house of Saul? David didn't say, hey, is there any perfect candidates out there that can serve in my army? Is there anybody moral over there? Is there anybody still left that can walk? No, he said, is there any? It means whosoever. Listen, Jesus, his message to you today, is there any? Is there anybody here that would like to trust Jesus to be your Savior? When heads bowed and eyes closed, sir, ma'am, you got to hear the bad news for you to hear the good news. You just heard the bad news that we are sinners in need of a Savior, and you cannot save yourself. You can have 1,000 lifetimes and live them all righteous, but the Bible says our righteousness, the best things that we do, are as filthy rags before the Lord. So it's not about trusting in our own works, the things we have done or can do, because it's all about Jesus and letting grace invade our lives. Sir, ma'am, if you're here and you never have prayed that prayer of repentance, you never have placed your faith in Jesus Christ, would you do it today? I want to lead you in this prayer. Listen, prayer is communication with our Father. It allows you to call upon God. I want to encourage you today, cry out to him. And if you're, I know logic is telling you right now, oh, that's never made sense to me. I never prayed before in my life. Listen, the most important prayer you will ever pray is not for financial prosperity. It's not for good health. The most important prayer you'll ever pray is when you pray to invite Jesus Christ to be your Savior and to be your Lord. Bar none. Because that enacts the power of the gospel. And hey, give me 25 days straight, and I still couldn't be able to touch the surface on how it happens, but I know it happens. That when we take our faith and place it, and we take our faith and reach out to God, we receive his gift of grace, which is his Son, Jesus Christ. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Sir, man, would you pray to invite Jesus to be your Savior and to be your Lord today? I'm going to lead you in this prayer. Pray it. Hey, pray it after me to our Father. Don't pray it to me. I can't save you. Make this prayer your own. Are you ready? Heavenly Father, I confess that I need to be saved. I want to be saved. Only you, Jesus, can save me. I invite you into my heart to be my Savior and to be my Lord. I take the reins of my life. I now place them in your hands. And with your strength and with your power, I will live for you the rest of my life. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Hey, would you look up here? Most of you are okay with that first part of the prayer, but that second part, preacher, that's kind of harsh. You mean take the reins of my life and place them in the hands of Jesus? I'm not sure if I can do that. As a new Christian, you might not wrap your mind around the concept of that, but Philippians 4:13 says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So I promise you, hey, you made that commitment today. You stand behind that commitment. You get into the Word of God, and the God of the Word will get into you, and He will give you the strength, because you try to get saved on your own, ain't going to happen. You try to live for Jesus on your own, it's not going to happen. But listen, the commitment you made right now today to accept Jesus, to come in your heart and your life, the only thing that I know that will validate it is following through with that commitment. And the best way is to get plugged into this Bible, into a Bible-believing church, so your faith can grow and blossom. And I'll talk to you about that if you come forward this morning. So if you prayed and had that moment of surrender today, would you meet me down front? I'm not going to ask you to raise your hands. Hey, raise your hands if you got saved. I'm not going to do it today. But as we stand and as we sing, would you just step out of your pew, come down with many aisles to get down here. Would you come this morning and share with me the decision you made? If there are other decisions, other prayers of commitment, would you come as well? Hey, I would love to pray with you. I want to minister to you. That's why I'm here. But if you just want to get along with our Father, just walk right past me. There's plenty of space down here to cry out to God today. As we sing, would you come? If you can stand, would you please stand with us as we sing our hymns of decision? Would you come?
The Savior is waiting to enter your heart. Why don't time after time.
I'll make one statement to you. We'll sing one more a verse of this, one more stanza of this invitation song, and we'll be done. And it's this song, the lyrics of this song reminds me of the state that I once read before, and here it is. There's nothing on earth that is worth going to hell for. It's very simple, but there's nothing, nothing on earth that is worth going to hell for. Absolutely nothing. You know, I don't know who needed to hear that or why you need to hear it put that way. You know, I remember hearing the old preacher say before, man, I wish I could just get one soul from hell to come back up here and stand and testify, and they would tell you, don't come to this place of damnation and destruction. Oh, it's hard trying to encourage it and to try to preach hell so hard, so hot and hard, you know, like the old preachers used to do. They do it so well at it. But I want you to understand the urgency. The eternity, that's a long time. You ever contemplated that? That's a long time. In 1,000 years from now, you still got millions and millions and millions. That's a long time to be separated from God in a place where the Bible says, describes where the worm dieth not. Listen, I just want you to see that urgency. It's nothing on earth worth going to hell for. As we sing, would you come?
If you'll take one step toward the Savior, my friend, you'll find His arms open wide. Receive Him and all of your darkness will end. Within your heart He'll abide.
Thank you for your kind attention. Please remain standing. I don't want you to sit. Brother Bill, if you'd come, he has just a few announcements to share with you about the youth department. So that's why I want you to not sit back down. Yeah, if you can leave and hold that mic there, brother, I appreciate that.
All right. Just real quick. Just want to run through a couple of things. Today we are heading to the Suns game for the Faith and Family Night. We're leaving at 2 o'clock for those who signed up. 2 o'clock. The bus is running. Amen. Mr. Farrell, we appreciate those. Mr. Ricky, we've got that thing done. We're going to put it to the test today. We're going to put it to the test, all right? This Wednesday night after class, after church, students are going to stay behind. We're going to play a game called Mission Impossible. It's a lot to explain. But we're encouraging kids to bring friends, but also bring $5 for food and help buy supplies and things like that. So we have that. And then next Sunday, July 5th, we're going to sponsor one more dinner for our students. And you say, you know, you had to change driving and all that. What we wanted to do is we're trying to figure out some things that's not going to overwhelm you. I know you guys, you give and you give. The change drive was one of those things. But everybody got to eat lunch, right? Amen? And who don't want, now I'm just going to put it to the test. Mr. Farrell's barbecue is legendary out here around here. So we're going to put that to the test next Sunday and see what it's all about. And so he's going to cook up some barbecue for us. If you can sign up, there's a sheet in the back. If you don't sign up, it's not a big deal. You say, well, Bill, I've already given all I could. We want you to come eat with us anyway. You know, Bill, I don't have the money to stay and eat. Come eat with us anyway. The way we do our dinners I've done for the last several years is just donations, whatever you can give. Some folks don't have any. That's fine. Come eat with us. We want to feed you. We want you to fellowship with us. We believe in that. If you can donate, whatever you can donate, that's fine too. I don't want to set a price because people get pushed away by that, those who just don't have. So we don't want that ever be the case. So that's kind of what we got going. It's our last thing. We're going to leave you alone. We go to camp the next week. So we thank you so much for your support the last couple of weeks. And that's kind of a picture of what we have going on now. I know we passed about 50 jars or so, maybe 60. I see there's about 8 of them over there. A couple have already been brought back. If you have pickles in your jars or peaches, whatever you put in, bring them back to us anyway, all right? If the jar's not full, that's okay too. But if you can bring those back tonight, and this, we're going to try to get that done. My first day here is Wednesday, so I'm going to try to get that changed, taken care of then. All right? Thank you, guys and gals.
Give it to him right there. Thank you, brother. All right. Would you please reach out to your neighbor? We'll sing our song of dismissal today.
We are one in the bond of love. We are one in the bond of love. We have joined our spirit with the Spirit of God. We are one in the bond of love. Let us sing now, everyone. Let us feel His love begun. Let us join our hands. One.